For 13 years, America outlawed alcohol. Prohibition was 13 years of madness, of speakeasies, rum running, and gangsters. But behind these legends are untold stories. Zealots who put the law up, like Kerry Nation and Billy Sunday. And the full truth of the gangster who brought it down, Al Capone. His brother was Two Gun Hart, a federal agent in Nebraska. It's a story of double standards. Joseph Kennedy in the pocket of the mob and corruption which led to the very top. Prohibition is told by the people who lived through it. A flapper who flouted it, an agent who enforced it, and a bootlegger who broke it. Prohibition was 13 years that changed America.
The slums will soon be a memory. Men will walk upright now, women will smile, and children will laugh.
On the night of January 16, 1920, all America seemed at peace. The country had enshrined an ideal. Prohibition had begun. An idea born in the rural Midwest had now become law in the big cities of America. All signs of liquor disappeared, but behind closed doors, alcohol still reigned in the world of the speakeasy. This underworld, the liquor flowed, immersed in decadence, absorbed with luxury. The fashions were daring, the dancing was liberated. Women could flaunt their sexuality. Prohibition was meant to usher in a golden era, a dry world, free from drink, free from crime and poverty. But this government-inspired morality sucked America into a fathomless sea of organized crime and bureaucracy, and a corruption that stretched from the meanest alleys to the White House itself. How could such a high ideal have cast a nation so low? The answer can be found in the very wording of the Prohibition Act itself, which outlawed the making, transporting, and selling of alcohol. But it was never against the law to drink, nor was buying liquor a crime. The risk was with the person who sold it. And so in post-war America, when the economy boomed and freedom was the spirit of the day, Prohibition seemed to cut against the grain.
I didn't notice Prohibition because everywhere I went, there was always, I had drinks with my dinner, or I'd go out in an afternoon and have some cocktails somewhere with some friends. It never registered, and I don't think it was with any of the people I knew.
According to the law, there were some dispensations. You could get alcohol from a doctor for medicinal use.
Doctors sold it, and they were allowed so much, and if you had a doctor friend, you'd go to him, and he'd sell you a prescription for a couple of bucks, and you'd sell the liquor. I used to get gin in my neighborhood, in my apartment, by calling up a number and saying, I want a couple of bottles of gin, usually two or one even. They'd deliver it to my apartment, Gordon Gin, so-called, $2.
Over 60,000 permits were issued to doctors in the first year. Priests and rabbis were allowed wine for religious purposes. The demand for sacramental wines increased by 800,000 gallons. As these small defiances of the law became accepted, drinkers became more daring. There was a thrill in defying prohibition. Drinking at home escalated to drinking in public, in the speakeasy. The thrill of the speakeasy was an irresistible adventure for the young Nona Friedman.
You had to know somebody in order to get into the so-called speakeasies. They had a little trap door right in the middle of the that saw your face when they opened up. And if you didn't know the password and they didn't know who you were, you couldn't get in. You really couldn't. So I guess the law was really pretty much on top of them, so they wouldn't permit it. And but everybody drank, they really did. So we learned what you're supposed to order and so forth and so on.
The Stork Club, the 21 Club, the El Fay, the Cotton Club. Before the first year was out, there were 5,000 speakeasies in New York City alone. By 1927, there were 30,000. The nation believed that this was the promised golden era. The style was pure opulence. Dana O'Connell was a dancer on Broadway with the Ziegfeld Follies. She was bewitched by the glamour.
Well, everything concerning the 20s was on a very high scale, very glamorous. Everything was just the finest that you could imagine. And to me, it was just like a great big bubble bursting. It was lovely. The people you met, the clothes you wore, the places you went. It was just elegant all the time. And of course, the champagne flowed plenty.
Before Prohibition, respectable ladies would never have entered the corrupt and squalid saloons. After all, it was women who had been at the forefront of the Prohibition campaign. But in Manhattan, one of the consequences of the new law was that women now drank alongside men.
As far as Prohibition being good for women, I think they were liberated, really. They didn't have to be in the kitchen all the time. They could go out to dinner. Wonderful. I guess they preferred to do that than stay at home like they used to. It was a whole revolution for women. Suddenly burst into one of these speakeasies and have anything they want to drink. They were in heaven. They were in heaven.
And some of them owned the speakeasies, like Texas Guinan. Her nightclub, the El Fay, was all the more fashionable because she was a woman.
Texas Guinan had a very famous saying. As you came in and were seated at a table, she'd say, "Hello, suckers." You know, she called everybody that. Yeah, that was her famous byword, you know. And she had wonderful entertainment. And that's how it was with her and the other clubs. She was a very charitable, lovely lady, even though she appeared very tough. But I think they liked that. They liked that, especially if they were picked out and called a sucker, you know. The men would usually laugh and have a good time.
Although Texas Guinan was a lawbreaker, her aspiring middle-class customers looked up to her.
It is the trendsetters, especially the urban middle class, who are the most likely to be violating prohibition. They're the ones who give us some of our most interesting images of the wild parties and the speakeasies and the like. So the middle class were interested in some ways in controlling the drinking of others, not necessarily changing their own drinking patterns.
To meet the thirst for drink, suppliers were driven to ever more risky and profitable ventures. Basements and back rooms became breweries and distilleries. New York was known as the city on a still. Fortunes were made by bootleggers. Zeke Alpern's father had been a struggling dime store keeper before Prohibition.
I was only about 10 years old. And all of a sudden, I saw a beautiful auburn automobile in front of our house. Oh, with the chrome going in the hood, you know, and it was a gorgeous car with the white sidewalls. And it was our car. It was my father's car. He was doing pretty good. And then I started going to sleepaway camp. And we bought a bigger house. And life was quite good. I used to come downstairs in the morning, and on the dining room table was money, lots and lots of money. And that's how I knew that times were good for us. And it was due to Prohibition, in a way. He took advantage of a situation, but I never looked at him as a criminal because it was the kind of thing that went on.
For Alpern, the rewards were great and the risks minimal. Violations for Prohibition were punished with $1,000 fines or, at the worst, 6 months in prison. But he could afford generous bribes.
How was he able to operate? Very simply. Every cop on the corner was on his payroll. And everybody looked the other way.
In a situation like this, straight police officers like Ed Skelly were powerless.
When I was on patrol, I could go by a storefront and I could smell the beer, the sour beer coming out from underneath the place. And you could open the door, had a blank front on it, like drawn curtains, big shades. And you could open and look in and see it. It was one about every 6 or 7 blocks. And that's what you call a local speakeasy. The law was illegal, and the judges were being fixed. The district attorney was being fixed. The guy who made the arrest, he was being fixed. They were all on the take. And I said, you went to a local bar, and you'd find 2, 3, 4 cops in there having a shot of whiskey. Or drink. And they made no arrest because they didn't believe in the law.
New York was swimming. Everybody drank, everybody. And it was never enforced. The police never enforced it because the people that owned them was crossing their palm with a little silver. And you know what that does. You could not hear, not see. So they got away with it a lot in New York.
This open lawbreaking compromised the local police and embarrassed the New York State Assembly. They washed their hands of it, and in 1923 handed over the enforcement of Prohibition entirely to federal agents.
The actions of the state of New York to withdraw its state enforcement of Prohibition began to increase doubts about the law and its public support on a national basis. New York was the center of national media attention, and so what the New York State Legislature did spread very rapidly across the country.